As I'd hiked up there, I'd hope, gee, I hope we don't get one here this year. Well, nature goes where it wants. The day Jolly Mountain fire started, there was a chance of lightning predicted. Conditions were really dry in spite of the good winter we had last year. There were sections of the forest up there that had at least 50% standing dead timber in it, which is a pretty big safety concern for ground firefighters. So when the fire started, conditions were ripe for a fire to, if it got started, to have some pretty good opportunity to grow, and it did.
I moved to Kittitas County in about 1973. Cleellum and Roslyn were sleepy little towns of 2,000 and 1,000 people. Basically, it was a logging community, railroad community. The mines had closed and there weren't a lot of jobs. There was no growth and no economic opportunity in Upper Kittitas County. When the state started to grow in population and the economics in the west side, people began to come over here to recreate. Kittitas County is about 70% public land or quasi-public, and it's a great playground with four seasons. Folks tend to migrate first into second homes and then into permanent residences. So what is not realized is that this is a fire environment. It historically has had fires since time immemorial.
Everywhere in the West, fire had an ecological role it played. In the Tanaway Valley, for example, we had photographic evidence from the early part of the 20th century that showed the fire scars, that showed the fires that had occurred up to that point. I think that was from the mid-1930s. So you could see very strong evidence of wildfire occurrence.
Over the last 100 years, the combination of a lot of industrial forest land ownership in the area because of the high productivity of the forest, combined with 100 years of fire suppression, aggressive fire suppression, we found that many of these pine stands are overstocked.
I don't think fire suppression's bad, but the result of putting every fire out set up conditions where we had an overstocked, which in real terms means an overcrowded stand.
In the last 5 years, there have been a number of wildfires. The first one that probably everyone remembers well is the Taylor Bridge fire. That was in 2012. It was followed that same season by the Table Mountain fire, which was a huge fire north of Ellensburg, north of the valley. The following year was another fire on the eastern edge of the county, the Clockham Tarps fire that came down from Chelan County. I think the year after that was a Snag Canyon fire. It was another lightning strike on the north side of the valley. And so we've had a pretty continuous streak of wildfires for the last few years.
Now we have a lot of people on the landscape that weren't naturally here, you know, over 100 years ago. So we need to get people used to thinking about how do they fit in with the ecology of the area. And that ecology would have included fire. So people need to be thinking about how am I adapted on my property for a fire coming through and making that defensible where firefighters can safely help the landowners out when there is a fire, because there will be fires in this area.
You can't always expect to have a fire engine in your yard during a major fire. You cannot do that. There aren't enough. And it's a matter of managing the risk.
We have to prioritize where we can protect and what we can protect with the resources we have. We have to make a tough choice about where we can actually be successful and walk away from the places we can.
When you say wildland, people think, you know, they really think wild and not a lot of or any home sites. You know, it's the place that you go to hike or the place that you go to camp, and you know, it's a long ways out of town, and it's really not. The wildland urban interface here in northern Kittitas County includes all the communities that are here. I mean, we're standing in it right now, and you know, we're in Cleellum.
The forest is in a continual state of change. It may look like it's not changing from day to day or even from year to year, but it is changing. The vegetation is changing. You know, the shrub and herbaceous layer is changing, and the trees are growing. And they're adding diameter and they're adding height. So it's a continual state of change. So what we try to tell them with a forest stewardship plan is that they need to keep track of that change and influence that change in order to create and maintain a healthy forest. WSU Extension Forestry has a program called Coach Stewardship Planning. The DNR has a program where they will cost share the forest stewardship plan. So the forest stewardship plan is kind of their handbook for taking care of their property.
We need all the help we can get from the landowners to have previously mitigated fuels to make it easier and less work for the firefighters. And they can deal with the flames and not dealing with all the extra fuel that's out on the landscape.
We work with homeowners associations to raise the level of their awareness and become a fire-adapted community. They recognize the need for access for initial response crews. They need to learn that they need to manage their vegetation so that in the event of fire, the fire is not a high-intensity fire, but it's a low-intensity fire. Then it becomes easier for the first responders to deal with it, either to manage it or to put it out.
So as a conservation district, we primarily work with private landowners. So any private landowner in the county can contact us. We have technical resources. We have staff that know about FireWise and fuels reduction techniques. We search out grant funding sources for landowners so we can help them with some of the costs of doing some of these projects. It's really our job to work with those private landowners on any of their resource concerns. And here it's really about forest health and fuels reduction and FireWise principles.
The one thing that Washington State east slopes of the Cascades can predict annually is a wildfire. We don't know where, we don't know when, but we know there'll be one.